Assalamu alaikum, goedemiddag. Dit is de Nederlandse Islamitische Omroep. De staat Israël viert haar 60-jarig bestaan. Tegelijkertijd herdenken de Palestijnen dat in 1948 ruim 800.000 mensen vluchteling werden. Niels Koop bezocht de ruïnes van Kakoen, een van de 500 dorpen die volledig werden verwoest. Israël viert feest. Er wordt uitgebreid stilgestaan bij de 60ste Onafhankelijkheidsdag. Terwijl in Israël feest wordt gevierd, herdenken de Palestijnen 60 jaar bezetting. Dwars door Palestijns grondgebied is de muur gebouwd. Dorpen en families zijn van elkaar gescheiden. 60 jaar na de oprichting van de staat Israël lijkt eenheid verder weg dan ooit. Dagelijks vernietigen van Palestijnse huizen roept bij de Palestijnen herinneringen op aan 60 jaar geleden.
Gestemd moet worden over het voorstel tot verdeling van Palestina in een zelfstandige Joodse en een Arabische staat. De Arabische prins Faisal leidt de oppositie tegen het verdelingsplan. De voorzitter maakt de uitslag bekend.
Of the Duck Committee for Palestine was adopted by 33 votes, 13 against, 10 abstentions.
Na het uitroepen van de staat Israël op 14 mei 1948 door David Ben-Gurion werden ruim 500 Palestijnse dorpen vernietigd. Ruim 800.000 Palestijnen werden uit hun huizen verdreven. Ze kwamen terecht in vluchtelingenkampen in de westelijke Jordaan-oever, Gaza en de omringende landen. Ze hoopten ooit terug te kunnen keren naar hun dorpen. Maar tot op de dag van vandaag staat Israël dat niet toe. Kampen van toen zijn nu uitgegroeid tot steden. Op de westelijke Jordaan-oever ligt de stad Tulkarm. Een paar kilometer verderop ligt Kakoen, een voormalig Palestijns dorp. Ethan Bronstein werkt bij Zochrot, een Israëlische organisatie die zich inzet voor erkenning van de gebeurtenissen tijdens de Nakba.
Here we are just in front of Kakoen. It's a place that the remains, of course, of the village that was destroyed and occupied in, the, in 1948. It was a Palestinian village then. There was a big battle here in 1948 when many Palestinians and Iraqi soldiers that came to help them were killed here, and the village was, or the villagers were kicked out from here and expelled from here. And of course the village was destroyed right after the occupation, and what remained of the village is only the top of the village was what was then the mosque, and it was formerly to the Palestinian village, it was a crusader fortress. So this is in fact what remained today from of Kakun.
Na het verwoesten van de Palestijnse dorpen werden er vaak vlakbij nieuwe Israëlische dorpen gebouwd. De bewoners van deze nieuwe dorpen en steden wisten vaak wel af van de ruïnes, maar wat het precies was geweest, was en is vaak onbekend.
Yeah, so I was living in a kibbutz named Bachan, which is just I think 3-4 kilometers from here to the other side of Kakun, and I was raised there since I was 5 when I came from Argentina directly to this kibbutz. And when I was a child, I don't remember exactly when was the first time, but I traveled around here. We traveled as kids, and I just knew the place. And I as a child, I visited here, I think hundreds of times. I don't know, many times. I love very much this place. We played there many times. We ate the saber, the cacti fruit, which is beautiful, full of thorns. But we knew how to deal with it, and so yeah, it's a place that I visited many times without knowing that it was a Palestinian village. I only knew then that it was a crusader fortress named Kakun, but I never knew about the Palestinian village there. To find out that this was a Palestinian village up to 1948 with 2,000 people living there. It was a rather big village, not a small one. And then I found out some details about this battle, and I was really shocked to find it. And this was a very crucial also point in my research on the Nakba and my work on the Nakba, because then I understood by my own experience how the ignorance is so big, because also as a child I was quite curious child. I asked questions. You know, if anyone in the past, in my past in the kibbutz, would have told me something about it, that it was Palestinian, I'm sure I would try to get some more information. And now, for example, I know that there are some Kakun refugees living around here in Palestinian villages, of course. Some, very few remained in Israel. Most of them, I know, many of them are living in Tulkarem, not far from here, a few kilometers from here. And if I would know then, I'm sure I would try to, I don't know, to look for people and to have some contact and to some information. But it was really amazing to find out how big is the ignorance about it.
Van Kakun bleek er bovenop de ruïnes een Israëlische vlag te zijn neergezet.
This flag issue is really for me very annoying thing. It's not always there, of course. It's for the 60th anniversary or the Independence Day of Israel. Almost everywhere they post flags, Israeli flags, and for me to see this flag there, it's really a sign of, you know, taking over the place. Now, it's been taken over already. For me, it's kind of exaggeration. Okay, you took over, you expelled the people, you don't let them return as it should be, and you post this flag, you know, this, for me, really ugly flag of symbolizing the occupation from 1948 and 67 and the expulsion, and you post this flag there. For me, I don't know, it's like you expel the people and then you, I don't know how you say, you step on them in a way, or you really humiliate them. And I think this is very Israeli, ugly way of showing how we are the owners and the only owners of this land, the only owners. We are the only ones who should be here. And this flag, for me, explains this very, very, very well.
Van de 500 Palestijnse dorpen die werden verwoest, is weinig meer over. Net als op vele andere plekken zijn de ruïnes van Kakkoen door de natuur overwoekerd. Nu is Kakkoen een natuurpark. Een aantrekkelijke plek voor Israëlische toeristen in eigen land.
כתוב מבצר עתיק, לא יודע.
לא, מה זה שווה כתוב?
אתם לא מהאזור?
לא. אה, הנה, כאן כתוב.
מה כתוב?
זה שם למעלה אולי.
כתוב שם בגדול, כתוב שם בקטן. מה אתה מצלם?
עושים איזה סרט על האזור, על המתעניינים באזור, אני יודע, משהו, כן. אז... אבל מעניין כמו מה זה נראה. לא יודע איך זה...
צריך לעלות, נראה.
כן. אתם מטיילים באזור, מה, בהרבה, כאילו, אתם קבוצה גדולה שמטיילים? מטיילת ככה ביחד? ואין לכם מפה של האזור? כאילו, איך עצרתם פה? למה באתם לפה?
באנו בדרך, ראינו מבצר.
היינו בבחן.
אה, פשוט, בבחן?
כן, היינו בבחן.
בקיבוץ בחן, באוטופיה, באוטופיה. כן, 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 שמעתי על זה. שמעתי שזה יפה, כן. רגע, ומשם? אבל משם אמרו לכם...
לא, יש במפה.
של המבצר?
לא.
לא, אבל איך באת? אני שואל איך משם באת?
על המפה מסומן מבצר.
על המבצר, על המפה מסומן מבצר. זה מה שאני אומר.
רגע, מה זה הצילולים האלה?
הם עושים, הם מתעניינים באזור. רוצים לראות ככה מקומות כאלה של... מקומות יפים באזור.
אתה לא מצלם אותנו, אתה לא שאלת אותנו אם מותר לצלם אותנו.
אל תדאגי, תשמעי, כשזה יהיה בערוץ, ב-CNN אולי או משהו כזה, אז תהיו מבסוטים.
אז שכרנו יבוא.
כן, כן, זהו, בדיוק. מה זה שיושב מחדש ומה זה?
עבדל לטיף אבו זה היה השייח האחרון של קקון והמנדט...
אבל קקון, מה זה פה? מה זה קקון פה?
קקון זה מקקו, מההתחלה הוא מסביר לך.
זה?
וקראו לו קקו. אתה לא רואה בהתחלה.
אבל מה זה, הצלבנים? מבלוקים? מה הם היו?
הרבה תקופות זה עבר.
זה התחיל עם צלבנים והטמפלרים, ואחר כך זה עבר לסולטן
והעותמנים. אבל מי ישבו אותו פה? כאילו אם הצבא... זה העותמנים? מה הם היו? ש... כאילו בשנות ה-30 של המאה ה-19 זה יושב מחדש על ידי מי?
לפני זה.
עותמנים. ערבים?
עותמני ואחר כך.
כי פה אני רואה שיש... היה שייח.
האחרון.
והיה
כשור.
כפר, אני רואה פה. זה שם הגדול הזה, מריקה. טול כרם.
ושואל כי אתה יודע?
אני מנחש.
אחינו מטול
כרם. כן. I always come here and I climb there. But I don't know now. It was all rubbles here, all the stones. And when we walk up, I told them there are stones around here. And you know, this is something amazing. When I was a child, all this was a barren hill. The hill was totally barren. It was not... there is still a way here. But this was all barren, and all the trees that you see are all new. Now this part, as far as I know, was the mosque also of the village. Oops. So this Tulkarem there, and the Bahan, the kibbutz I was living is just here, just down here. We see some houses of the kibbutz. Just behind it is Shweike village, which is beyond the green line. The green line is the occupied territories today, Shweike, but it was getting bigger. And here near is Biresike and Jat, all villages in Israel today. I mean, since 1948, it's Israel. But Tulkarem, of course, it's beyond the green line and the wall there. And many refugees from Kakun, from this place, are living just near here. And you know, I had an idea. We never had a commemoration or something here, a tour. I really have to do something. We must do something with it. And I always thought that we have to connect the place, Kakun, with the refugees there. And I'm sure it's possible. I mean, visual connection, because we can do some, I don't know, fireworks or something here to connect and to do something with them and to talk with them when we commemorate it and to hear stories. I don't know, I'm sure we can do something nice with them. And it's amazing, you know, they see their village. From there, they can see it. I'm sure I never talked to them, but I'm sure they can see here and they can relate to their place and to show their kids. And so when they want to return, they really see the place they should return to. So this is for my friend Salah Mansour. This is for you, Salah Mansour, my friend. You have a present for me. I keep this flag for you when you come. I feel important about the Israel flag, that it's important to keep it, you know. I never thought this will happen, but always there is a first time. They totally renovate the place, they change it totally. But it's good that they keep it. At least they keep it, you know, they don't destroy it. So if it wouldn't be crusaders here involved, they would perhaps, probably, you know, destroy it. Because if it's only a mosque, you know, they can destroy it. But thank you. we arrived here and I saw the flag, I felt really angry to see this flag there. In a way, I felt shamed as Israeli. And I felt also responsible to do something about it, because this flag there symbolizes our occupation and expulsion of these people here. But there is also some personal issue for me that I remember the last time I met a very good friend of mine named Salah Mansour, that he... it will be difficult for me to talk a bit. So I met, it was a month ago, I think in Chicago, a friend named Salah Mansour, and this friend, we have a long contact. I mean, some 5 years, he's the moderator of Palestine Remembered. And a long time he pushed us to work on this. Encourage us and comment always on what we are doing. And also, he writes me personal emails, about his own family. When I met him now in Chicago, the first time I knew that he's from Cancun. His father was from Cancun. And he told me that his father was fighting to liberate Jenin in the same day that Cancun fell, 1948, and he never overcome this until the last day of his life, thinking that he wasn't where he should be to try to help Cancun people, his fellows. And when Cancun fell and many people killed here, he was in another place. And I don't know, I feel like kind of a responsibility for him when I see this flag. And I don't know, I feel like I want to do something for him. He cannot come back here. Until now, I hope he will. And I'm not sure even if he can come to visit this place. And as I told you there in Chicago, I know that I know his own village better than he knows. I know the place, I know the stones there and everything. And for me, having the possibility to come here and to do something, like I feel that I do something for him. And I don't want this flag to be there, and I just wanted to be down.
Cancun is slechts een van de ruim 500 dorpen die in 1948 werden verwoest. Van sommige dorpen is helemaal niks meer over. Van andere dorpen zijn er alleen nog ruïnes te vinden. In het Israëlische beleid zijn deze dorpen niet erkend. Het zijn slechts stenen van oude tijden die te bezichtigen zijn in de natuurparken. Net als de 2000 inwoners van Cancun werden tijdens de Nakba ruim 800.000 Palestijnen vluchteling. Ze kwamen terecht in kampen. De vluchtelingen mogen niet terug naar Israëlisch grondgebied. Ze hebben hun oude dorpen dus nooit meer teruggezien. Het recht op terugkeer van deze vluchtelingen is sinds 1948 een voorwaarde geweest van de Palestijnen bij vredesonderhandelingen. In Israël wordt de Nakba verzwegen. Hoe kan deze impasse doorbroken worden?
First step is knowing the stories, knowing not only that it was a village that was occupied by Alexandroni unit as it's written on the sign, but also what's happened to them, what's happened to the other side. The other side of the story is not told at all. There were fighters, Palestinian fighters. As I said, we can collect their testimonies. We can bring their story. We can see where they live today, what they want today, And we can also know and research how did they live before 1948. How were the relations here between Jews and Arabs in the area? What did they do for their living? So all this is knowing the Nakba, knowing it.
Second step is to acknowledge the loss of the Palestinian people, society. So for us as Israelis, we must acknowledge this, recognize our responsibility, and this recognition or acknowledgement is the initial step for any possibility of reconciliation between the two sides. Because when I'm talking about reconciliation, it's not about peace only. I'm not talking about peace. Peace agreement you can have between leaders, it's a political, legal agreement. I'm not talking about peace. Even if there will be peace, there will never be reconciliation and possibility to live really together as citizens, equal citizens and inhabitants of this land, unless we recognize, we as Jewish Israelis, recognize and acknowledge our responsibility in this expulsion and this tragedy of the Palestinians. Now, we have to work for their return. And this acceptance of their return is the perhaps the most important component of all this recognition. But it's all, as I see it, it's all kind of a packet that you cannot take out some component out of it. But yes, of course, the first thing is knowing and acknowledgement of what's happened here and our responsibility, yes.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من أجل ذلك كتبنا على بني إسرائيل أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا ومن أحياها فكأنما أحيا الناس جميعا ولقد جاءتهم رسلهم بالبينات ثم إن صدق الله العظيم.
De NIO is elke zondag te zien om 3:00 op Nederland 2 en wordt herhaald op zaterdagochtend rond 11:00. Op radio zijn wij te beluisteren met Het Andere Geluid elke dinsdagavond van 10 tot 11:00 en met De Horizon op zaterdagavond van 19:30 tot 8:10, beide op Radio 5. Voor al uw reacties en achtergrondinformatie, kijk op onze website nioweb.nl. Goedemiddag, salamu alaikum.